second, but she's not. She's going first. And so those will be the questions that you will answer when she's complete.
In 2008, I had discovered my husband was having an affair. I was heartbroken. I was angry. I didn't know what to do. So I cried out to God, seeking his wisdom and his guidance. Because honestly, I wanted to run. Divorce was the only thing I thought was an option. Thankfully, I found a counselor. And she told me I had a choice to make. I could choose to walk away, which most people told me I should do. Or I could choose to stay and fight for my marriage and seek God as I did that. A scripture that continually came to mind during this time period was from Romans 12:2. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. A couple months later, my husband suffered a massive heart attack, followed by atrial fib, a hernia surgery, emergency gallbladder surgery, a foot surgery, a knee surgery. He had very serious health problems, and it all climaxed in 2011 with a stroke. I find myself in the role as a caregiver to my husband, a person I didn't even like. So I cry out to God, and I say, Lord, you promise that you will not give us more than we can handle. You say that in your word. Well, I'm done. I've had it. I can't do this anymore. I need you to fix my husband. Because I know with all my heart, I know you can. But if you won't, then take him. Take my husband. Because I just need to be able to grieve and get on with my life. It was not long after this, but I discovered the horridness of what I just asked God to do. So as I cried out to God again, this time on my knees, begging God, please forgive me. I am so selfish. Please forgive me for being so selfish. But I'm overwhelmed. I don't know what to do. I don't know how to love my husband. I need you to show me how to love my husband the way that you desire me to love my husband. Because I just can't. And I was reminded, again, taken back to scripture. This time it was, as Jesus says in Matthew, come to me, all who are weary and burdened. And so lovingly, so graciously, the Lord surrounded me with his people. People who reminded me of God's goodness, God's faithfulness. Telling me this was just a season, that I needed to seek him during this season because it was only God who can fill me with peace and love and joy that I needed during this time. My husband's now in kidney failure. We're going to dialysis 5 to 6 hours a day, 3 to 4 days a week. One day when I was driving my husband home from a dialysis appointment, he looks at me and he says, Rebecca, will you be tested? And I look at him like, tested for what? And he says, will you be tested to see if you can give me a kidney? I'm ashamed to say, in my head, I laughed. I'm like, you've got to be kidding. This has got to be a joke. Absolutely not. But I say, oh, hon, how could I do that? Taking care of you, the kids, the house, and everything else. I can't do that, because I can't do that if I'm recovering from a surgery. is just impossible. Next, we're waiting for a date for my husband to have open heart surgery. And I had the perfect plan of how everything was going to work out, where I was going to stay, where the kids would go, all the details figured out. My plan, my perfect plan, fell apart. Nothing that I thought was going to happen, happened. So again, I find myself crying out to God, saying, Lord, I know you have a plan for this time. I don't know what it is, but Lord, please reveal your plan to me of how this is all going to play out. And I waited, trying to be so, so patient. And my dad, he would call me almost every day, saying, Rebecca, what's your plan? What do you need me to do? And I'd say, I don't know. I don't have a plan. I have no idea. But I tried to be so patient. It's now a week before the surgery. I have no plan. So as I'm getting ready in the morning, I'm talking to God, and I said, Lord, I trust you have a plan, and it's an amazing plan. Could you please, please, Lord, I beg you to share that plan with me. And within a couple hours, I received a phone call from a friend who had recently moved to the city where the surgery was going to be. And she says, come stay with me. Stay as long as you need. A couple hours later, I receive another phone call. This is from the person who was supposed to originally watch my kids. Is now available, can watch them as long as we need them to. A couple hours later, I get another phone call. It's my husband's sister, who lives up in Oregon, and she says, I'm between jobs, kids are out of school. I can come down, stay at the house, do whatever you need, as long as you need. Within that afternoon, God just laid out his plan right in front of me. And I was reminded that as we ask and continue to seek and continue to knock, that God will answer because he is good. So we're preparing for this week in the city, and I am terrified of the city. I drive a minivan, and the parking places, the structures seem oh so tiny, and I feel oh so big, and I'm overwhelmed. But through that week, I felt like God held me by the hand and guided me through every step. Every day, every moment, I was just filled with his presence, and I felt at peace. And during that week, he spoke to me, and he said, Rebecca, you trusted and waited for my plan. I want you to trust in my plan and go be tested. So I did. A couple weeks later, I received a phone call from the lady who was in charge of my case at the kidney center. And I answer, and she says, Rebecca, I have news. Your test results are in. And I remember in my head thinking, oh, her voice is a little too chipper for me right now. And I say, okay. She says, you're a perfect match. You get to give your husband a kidney. I was, honestly, at that moment, I wanted to throw up. So I get home, because I was on the road at the time. I had absolutely no plan of saying one word of this to my husband. I needed time to process. But as soon as I walk in that door and I see my husband, the first thing out of my mouth is, I'm a match! And he, oh goodness gracious. But that's all he said. I'm a match. As the news spread that I was giving my husband a kidney, even though I didn't say that, everyone around me is rejoicing, praising God. It's a miracle. Thanking me, telling me how gracious I am, how fabulous I am. such an amazing wife to do an amazing thing. And all I could do was shake my head and smile. God is good. God is faithful. But inside, I was angry. I did not want to do it. I didn't want to do it. Over the next few weeks, I had to go through several tests to make sure that my body was perfectly healthy to handle the surgery. Now, usually when you go to the doctors, you want to hear that everything's great, right? You want good news. I didn't want good news. Secretly, I prayed that they would find something, some small little thing that'd be like, oh, Rebecca, I'm so sorry. And I'd be like, oh, darn. But I got a thumbs up every time. Every time. And it's now a week before the surgery, and I realize that my body was in the right place to give a kidney, but my mind, my heart, was not. So I cried out to the Lord again, and I said, how can you ask me to do such a thing? Something for someone that has done such awful things to me, has treated me. How could you ask me to do such a thing? And why is everyone around me praising you for this? Like, Lord, I know you're calling me to this. I'm going to be obedient. I'm going to do it. But please, Lord, share the joy. Help me to see the goodness in this. Fill me with your joy before I walk into this. And so throughout that time, as I was praying and just listening, hoping for a word from God, he brought me back to the week in the city where he carried me through. He held my hand through the entire week. He reminded me of that. And he said, I picked you to give this gift to your husband. Now trust me. So for the next week, I felt at peace. I understood the joy that everyone around me was experiencing, the praise, because I realized he wasn't picking on me. He had picked me. And it was a gift. In Philippians it says, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. I had God's peace as I went into the surgery. I no longer saw the darkness, but I was able to see God's light. It was by the grace and the love of our unstoppable God, our amazing God, that allowed me to give my husband a kidney and bring healing to his body. Our time together used to be filled with resentment, sadness, anger, disappointment. But now it's filled with joy. We share what our days are filled with, our hopes for the future. We allow each other to work in our giftings. We encourage one another. We praise one another. We now compliment each other the way that God created a husband and a wife to compliment each other. So as I called out to God, as I continually seeked him and his plan and his trusting his timing, he revealed himself and his plan and his perfect timing. God has a plan and a purpose for each of you. And I would encourage you each to as he reveals his plan and his purpose to you in whatever season you're in right now, to just lean in on him as he walks you through that. Thank you.